Go ahead and keep on eating your lunch. It's my suspicion that it's been a long time since y'all had to stand in line for a school lunch, right? What I want y'all to know is that, indeed, this is a menu that was taken directly from the Bibb County School District lunch menu. It is nutritionally balanced, has all the right number of calories to sustain you. But what we wanted to do was to ask you to think for a moment about the fact that for many of the children in our public schools, this may be the best, and we hope not only, but sometimes only meal that they get until lunch the next day. So as you finish eating, just think about that. I do promise you that at the reception this afternoon at the medical school foyer, where the photography exhibit is, you will have slightly more elegant and conventional food. So if you leave here hungry, we're gonna feed you again at the end of the day. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Mary Alice Morgan. I'm Senior Vice Provost for Service Learning here at Mercer. And I wanna point out that on the table, you have a brochure about service learning that says, at Mercer, everyone majors in changing the world. That really is the ethos here at Mercer. And so we have students, if you open up that brochure, you'll see that we have students from all the different colleges and schools within the university who go out into the community and share their areas of expertise as well as their community-mindedness and heart for service with Macon. And in addition to that brochure, you'll see a little card that says Research That Reaches Out. This is a new initiative here at the university, and we're really excited about it. It is part of a quality enhancement plan that we go through for accreditation. But this is not, to us, simply an accreditation checkbox. We are thrilled to be thinking about and embarking upon connecting the university's unique talents and contributions to the community, our capacity for research and innovation and experimentation with then service to the community. So you're going to hear a lot more about Research That Reaches Out, but we wanted you to at least be introduced to it today. So I'm one of the planners, one among many of the planners of this event today. And I'm looking out over the crowd, and I am so pleased because we have here a very diverse group. I'm just going to ask for shows of hands for a second. How many undergraduate students? Just raise your hands. All right, so you've got some undergraduate students. How many people affiliated with medicine and the medical profession? Okay, and we'll probably have a few more. They were going to arrive late, coming from one of their med school classes. So we'll make room for them when they arrive. How many government or elected officials, Macon-Bibb officials in the room? All right, so happy that you're here. How many folks from the media? Well represented. How many service providers? How many of you would consider yourself to be service providers? A good contingent. And then business people, economic development folks. How about those? All right. So you can see this is a really diverse group, and that's what we wanted, because part of what today is going to be about is a think tank. As we end after the concurrent sessions after lunch, we're going to walk down to the medical school auditorium, and you have a map, a walking map in your brochure. And we're going to brainstorm together and do some cross-sector talking. So just be sort of thinking about that as the day goes on and get ready for that particular part of the program. I also just want to call your attention to the program and say that there's a lot of information in here that is pertinent to the issues that we're talking about, some statistics about poverty, some additional information about the various organizations who've partnered to bring this discussion about today. So I hope you will want to hang on to this and not simply put it aside at the end of the day. I hope you'll want to go back and read it more carefully. There's a letter in the program from me that says, I think, what part of the purpose of this conference is. It says, Macon is, and I'm actually quoting from somebody else, programmatically rich, but systematically poor. Meaning that so many of our organizations do heroic work putting infrastructure around our outreach and community activities, but much of that tremendous effort never has the maximum impact that we seek because we can't reach that tipping point of transforming the surrounding circumstances. So part of what we want to explore today pull it up here. And some of you've heard this concept before. But it's all about collaborating, coordinating. As you can see here, when we're all doing our thing separately and going in different directions, you don't make a lot of forward movement or progress. But when you can align, coordinate, and collaborate, and all get going in the same direction, then you can make progress forward. So that trying to reach that tipping point toward collective impact is part of what we're seeking. So now let us move into the program. I'm going to introduce each of our luncheon speakers now. And then just ask each of them to come up in turn without being reintroduced. Just come out up after the previous speaker. So our first speaker is President Underwood. He needs no introduction. His leadership is changing the face of the university and the face of Macon. Everything from the new Tatnall Square Arts Center, which is going to be available to the public, not just for the university, to last week's magnificent performance of Robert McDuffie and the Center for Strings students with Anna Devere Smith reading Letter from Birmingham Jail. I don't know about you, but for those of you who were there, that was a peak moment in my life in Macon. It was one of the most unifying and moving moments in my 34 years here. We have John Berry, who's the executive director of St. Vincent de Paul. If you don't know this organization, I urge you to go to their website to see the tremendous work that they do, not just in providing services for the homeless and the hungry, but in lobbying and testifying before legislatures to advocate for the state's most vulnerable citizens. Mr. Berry, we are grateful to you for your work and for bringing Profiles of Poverty to the exhibit here in Macon. And it will be here all month, so if you don't get a chance to have your fill of it today, please come back and urge others to come with you. Sister Elizabeth Greim is the executive director of Daybreak and is probably well known to you as kind of a force of nature here in Macon. She has managed to do what others had tried to do for years, which was to open a day shelter for the homeless. Sister is a determined and fierce advocate for upholding the worth and dignity of the least of these. We are in your debt. George McCandless is on the program. He's president and CEO of United Way of Central Georgia. He was unexpectedly and unavoidably called out of town today after having worked so hard to make sure this summit happened. He's a real key instigator for this conference. He sends his best. He wants to hear from you how it went. And I'm going to do my best to impersonate him and deliver his presentation. United Way is embracing and pioneering the collective impact concept. And then our keynote speaker at the very end is Mayor Robert Reichert, who is truly a servant leader to Macon-Bibb. going into, I think, his eighth year of office as the chief officer of city government. He has been indefatigable in supporting downtown renewal, eradication of blight, creation of the shalom zones, and numerous other initiatives. So please give all of our speakers a round of applause. President Underwood.
Mary Alice, stay here for just a minute. My role is to welcome you, so welcome to Mercer and to Macon and to what promises to be a really extraordinary summit. You see on the back of the program the list of people who have participated on the planning committee to plan this fantastic summit, folks from the United Way and the University and Macon-Bibb County and St. Vincent de Paul of Georgia, and they've obviously done splendid work just from looking at around the room and seeing the number of leaders from our community and around the state who have taken time out of their busy schedules to be here. And it is great having all of you here. But when Mary Alice says she's just one of the many planners, that's nonsense, of course. Judging from the number of emails I've gotten from Mary Alice pestering me about this event, I suspect that that she's more than just one among the many. And let's thank Mary Alice for her efforts. She has planned carefully. She gave me a strict time limit, and then she gave me what I was supposed to say. And I can't say this in the time limit she's given me. Fortunately, I don't have to, because the first item is to tell you that your luncheon is a school lunch and that it's nutritionally balanced and contains the specified number of calories. She's already told you that and everything else on my list. So I don't need to cover any of it. I will say that I think Macon is a place that is accomplishing remarkable things today. I picked up the new issue of Georgia Trend magazine this morning, and it begins the story on Macon by saying it's been a long time coming, but Macon is back. I think the sentiment of that is a positive sentiment. I'm not sure we want to go back anywhere, and I don't think we want to go back anywhere, but I think the sentiment is that Macon is a community that's on the move, and I think that's unmistakable when you look at what's going on throughout our community. When you look at all the new lofts downtown and the restaurants and bars that are opening and the economic activity that's taking place in downtown Macon and the jobs that are being created, and you look at what's happening with the private investment in the College Hill corridor and the areas surrounding our campus, I think the only conclusion you can reach is that Macon is a community that's on the move, and that's wonderful, that's fantastic. I think we've still got a lot of progress ahead of us, and the good news is that I think we're going to be making progress by leaps and bounds in the years ahead. I think everyone in this room understands that Macon cannot achieve its full potential without addressing the issue of poverty in meaningful and substantive ways in this community. We have a poverty rate of about 23.5% in Macon-Bibb, and we've got to take that on. And many of you are taking it on, and I hope that one of the outcomes from this summit is that we'll find ways to coordinate our efforts to be even more effective in addressing the issue of poverty. We've got a high school dropout rate of about 8.5%. About 8.5% of the young men and women between the ages of 16 and 19 in Macon-Bibb are high school dropouts. Those are young people that have very dismal economic futures, and we've got to address that issue. 60% of our live births in Macon-Bibb are to unwed mothers, and that's a special challenging circumstance that we're going to have to find ways to address if we're going to be successful. But the good news is there's enough talent in this room to come up with ideas and strategies for us to be effective as a community in taking on the challenge of poverty and viewing it as an opportunity to really drive our community forward. So thank you for taking the time to be a part of this important summit. Mary Alice, I made it in the time you gave me.
Thank you, President Underwood. I'm not sure I'm going to make it in the time that was given me, so I appreciate you giving some up. My name is John Berry. I'm the CEO and Executive Director of the St. Vincent de Paul Society for the State of Georgia, and I'm just thrilled beyond words to be here today. I want to thank Mercer University. Macon is blessed to have Mercer here. Our office in Chamblee, where my office is just down the street from your Atlanta campus, and we have great respect for what Mercer does. The city, Macon-Bibb, the mayor, United Way, everybody. Special shout out to Melissa Winkler from my staff, who has been down here in Macon working to get profiles of poverty put in place and get this set up. So thanks to all of you. I wanted to tell you a little bit about us, not from the perspective of trying to brag on what we do, although we're pretty proud of it, but rather to give some context to the few brief remarks I do want to make on the issue of poverty. We, if you don't know, have been operating here as a human services organization in the state of Georgia for 110 years. We started in, actually 112, we started in 1903 in Atlanta. And we have grown now with a statewide footprint. We have 76 local volunteer organizations throughout the state that help support people in need. We have 5,800 volunteers. We operate 16 separate facilities. And food is one of the biggest things that we deal with. The comments that were made about school lunches, and the fact is that more children than you would want to think about do not eat if they do not go to school. So while some kids celebrated the snow last week and the fact that they could stay home, more kids suffered because they stayed at home and didn't eat. So we try to alleviate that. We process right now somewhere between 40 and 50 tons of food per month that's distributed out to 38 food pantries. We have a program we operate with Kroger and the Atlanta Community Food Bank to distribute food from Kroger out through the food pantries. We celebrated our 100th year as a large multi-unit organization last year, and in trying to decide how do we best note that 100-year anniversary, we went through the standard list of let's have a big gala, let's run, let's put signs up, let's put gold stars on our letterhead, and kind of came to the realization that wasn't what we wanted to do. That wasn't who we are. So we came up with the concept of profiles of poverty. And the idea behind profiles of poverty, and I want to thank Georgia Power, because Georgia Power stepped in and funded profiles of poverty to have those pictures that you'll see today mounted and framed and all that effort. So a generous donation from Georgia Power. But what the idea was, let's do something that will ignite a conversation, that will begin a dialogue, that will highlight the issues around poverty and maybe in some ways make people uncomfortable. Poverty is an issue that, although this year I'm starting to hear it from some people, if you go back to the 2012 presidential election, I don't think the word poverty was spoken by any candidate at any time in that election cycle. That's unacceptable. At the state level, at the local level, we need to get this issue to the forefront. We need to start talking about it. So the idea behind Profiles of Poverty was, let's do something in a dignified, respectful manner that highlights what does poverty look like, so people start talking about it. And I'll tell you the kind of success it had. We launched it at the Colony Square office complex in Atlanta last year for a month. And the night of the opening reception, the president, the new president of the Metro Atlanta Chamber of Commerce, Hala Mottlemog, came to that exhibit and saw that exhibit and said, that exhibit has to be seen by others. So she offered and created an opportunity for that exhibit to sit at the Metro Atlanta Chamber of Commerce headquarters for 2 weeks. Think about it. A 50-photo exhibit about poverty sat at the Metro Atlanta Chamber, where some of the biggest movers and shakers in the Metro Atlanta region come on a regular basis. That has then gone to the Atlanta Regional Commission. It sat for a month, 2 months at the Atlanta Regional Commission in their offices, and then the Atlanta Regional Commission said, we love it so much, we want it for another month. It's coming here to Macon. Thank you to Mercer. It's going to Columbus, Georgia. It's going to Savannah. It's starting to do what we wanted it to do, which was ignite a conversation, light a fire, get people thinking about it. So the people we serve in this state and in this nation come from every corner of the state. We have people we serve in Blairsville, and we have people we serve in Brunswick. We have people in Metro Atlanta, and we have people in downtown Savannah. We have people in Columbus, we have people in Lake Hartwell. We deal with and support the needs of a diverse population, diversity in ethnicity, faith, religion, age, gender, and circumstance, all kinds of people. And for many of those people, the need we serve is episodic. It is the result of a life event that has them in a temporarily financially unstable situation. And that situation, if not addressed, could create a cascading and longer-term problem. But in general, the situations are usually time-bounded, and the cause is known and correctable. And the classic example is in our dysfunctional medical system right now, with high deductible insurance policies and a lack of insurance, a family that's barely making it day to day has a child on a bicycle who falls and breaks his or her arm. And now there's a $2,000 medical bill for x-rays and casts and orthopedics, and that knocks them off the rails. Well, that's an example of something that we can deal with on a regular basis. But it's the others that we help, the thousands and thousands of others that we help. We helped 155,000 people last year in the state of Georgia who don't fall into that category that we and you here today are challenged to find realistic, sustainable, and affordable ways to help. I believe from the evidence that we've seen in our work and from the evidence that exists, that almost every situation of poverty, need, and dependence can be addressed by, needs to be addressed at the fundamental root of addressing one of the three, what I call the pillars, the legs of the stool: opportunity, ability, and accessibility. Opportunity is jobs, economic development. People say, why is St. Vincent de Paul actively involved with the Metro Chamber and the Georgia Chamber? Well, because those are places that help create jobs. And the way we can get people out of poverty is get them into jobs. However, the second leg is ability. They need education, they need training, they need the ability to be able to hold those jobs that are available for them to achieve financial self-sufficiency. And then there's accessibility. Not only transportation, which is what immediately comes to most people's mind when you say accessibility, but childcare and affordable housing. A job for a single mother is no job if she has nothing to do with her children, and she can't get her children to be cared for, or if the cost of childcare exceeds what she's making or matches what she's making in the job. So make no mistake, these are interdependent and interrelated. They're three legs of the stool, and the stool doesn't stand if any one of those legs is broken or missing. I believe many of the failures in poverty programs that we've seen over the last 50 plus years can be directly tied to the fact that we have focused on one leg and not all three of them. Overarching these three legs of the stool, there must be a determination and a will, and there can be no doubt about that. People must be willing to learn, they must be willing to work, and they must be willing to try. But we have to ensure the work that they do, through the work that we do, that work that they do has a payoff, that there is an end in sight. We must be the ones that provide hope to those people so that when they go through what they do, we have reward at the other side. Now, there are those people that say, well, all people have to do to get out of poverty is pull themselves up by their bootstraps. Well, I think what some people forget is there are many people that don't own boots. So we have a responsibility to figure out how to deal with that. There are a lot of people that say, all you have to do is climb the ladder of success. I did it. Well, some people don't know where the ladder is. So our job is to get them to the first rung and teach them how to climb. Our challenge then, our mission, our responsibility, is to help create, sustain, and support policies and programs that empower people to move from poverty and dependence to stability and self-sufficiency. We at St. Vincent de Paul have committed ourselves to work one person at a time, one human interaction at a time, treating each person with dignity and respect as a human being with another human being working to help them solve that problem. I believe every one of you sitting in this room today are here for the same reason. For my mind, Profiles of Poverty has worked again. It didn't create this poverty summit, but it has helped light that fire in that poverty summit. Before we started today, somebody asked me about, well, these are all nice words. I've heard a lot of nice words. What are we going to do to actually drive change and make this thing happen? And my answer was through you, through the community. It is we who are the donors, the workers, the funders, the governments, the businesses, the NGOs that drive the work through driving the change that we do, driving the change and forcing the change that we do. This Poverty Summit today is part of that conversation. I applaud your efforts in doing it. I applaud your dedication in being here. I'm proud to be part of it, and I look forward to working with you so that together we can learn how to change lives one at a time. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Good afternoon, I guess. When Mary Alice first talked with me about coming and speaking today, I wasn't quite sure exactly what I wanted to say. And now that I look out here, I think at least more than half of the room could be up here to talk about these issues. So I can only speak about my experience and the experience of those I work with. And I know that each of you at your tables and those of you who I work with in the trenches to work with those who are homeless know that we're all out there trying to do the best we can so that others can be the best that they can be. So I just want to tell you a little bit about what I do and how I've come to understand the work that I do. So I looked at some things about Macon, and President Underwood said, poverty in Macon, the census statistics say that there's about 23% of the residents of Macon who live in poverty, which means they live below the poverty line. So I looked up, what's the poverty line? What does that look like? And for a family of four, three children, one adult, two adults, two children, it's about $24,000 a year. So you can do the math on that yourselves, you can look up these statistics. That's a little striking to me, four people on $24,000 a year. I don't know how families can survive on that. When Chuck Levesque, the director of DePaul USA, asked if there was poverty in Macon, I thought, well, where is it? Their poverty. Where is there not a place where you will find people who live in vulnerability? And then he asked me, are there abandoned buildings in Macon? And I thought, well, that's an interesting question. Part of the question was, is there a place where we could come and open up a center to do something that would help with the issues of homelessness specifically in Macon? The other issue was that abandoned buildings are an indication that people are either leaving or they're not able to sustain the infrastructure that exists. So to me, that was an interesting question. Are there abandoned buildings? I hated to say more than you can imagine. I hated to say that there are nights that I think if the lights went out in my house in Pleasant Hill, I would have to take a walk outside the campus of Peter Claver to find a house that should have lights on, because so many of the buildings around me are abandoned and don't have anybody living in them. But we know that we have a plan for that. We know that there are issues and we're concerned about these things. And I think that's one of the best things I know about Macon, is that in the 10 years I've been here, we've not been afraid to look at the vulnerabilities of our community, and we've not been afraid to find out solutions that work for us. When DePaul USA wanted to come, what we asked was, what are the gaps in the services? And what services are not meeting capacity? We didn't say, we know what poverty is, we know what homelessness is, and this is what we're going to come in and do about it. We needed to understand what the poverty and the homeless situation was in this city, and it looks different than any other city. And every city has its own look and its own feel because its people are individuals. And that's one of the most important messages, I think, that we come away from today. When we put words like poverty, homelessness, living below the poverty line, we're talking about human beings who live in a particular condition. We're talking about people. And when we remember that, we remember then that it's about all of us. I was saying to someone earlier, when you ask someone where they're from, if you came down to Daybreak and you asked everybody in there where they're from, they would all tell you they're from Macon. They wouldn't say, I'm from the river, or I'm from North Macon, I'm a volunteer. They wouldn't say, I'm from downtown. They would say, I'm from Macon. Everybody there is a citizen of Macon. Some whose roofs are the stars of the sky, some have roofs of canvas tents, some have roofs of clay or cement, or we all live in different environments, and yet we all live in the same community, some of us more vulnerably than others, but each of us a contributing member in whatever way we can. So what I discovered was that while people said the reason downtown can't get better is because there's so many homeless people down there, I went down and I asked all those people who looked like they were homeless. I asked the people who the shopkeepers and the restaurant people said, those are the homeless people over there. And what I found was that they all weren't homeless, but they all lived in poverty. They were all sitting outside in the street because they couldn't afford to be inside the restaurant. They were sitting outside the street because they lived in the low-income housing that sits on the corner of Cherry and 3rd Street. They were sitting outside because they loved their city and their downtown and their fountain, but they couldn't afford to engage in the other works that were happening in the city. There wasn't an issue exclusively of homelessness, but it was an issue of poverty. And once we began to sort those things out, we began to realize that the other issues we face, the other poverty we face, is aloneness and sometimes boredom. People wander about the city because they're bored. They want something to do. Those of us who can afford it, we have recreation. We go to the movies. We go to places. When you can't afford it, you can't do it. And your life can become stagnant. Those are the things we began to realize. When we started with Daybreak and said we were going to engage in things like letting people play checkers and rest, and everyone said, oh, you're just going to be enabling them. I thought, well, we might need to enable a little bit. Because what I came to realize was that tired, bored adults are not easily motivated. Hungry children can't learn, and tired adults don't want to do anything. When you go home at the end of your day and put your feet up and someone says, honey, can you do this? Or dear, can you get that? Oh, it's a little moment when you don't want to do it. You just got home from work. Imagine when there's no place to put your feet up. That's what homelessness looks like. When we slept out in the park the other night and last year, and people said to me, well, you know, you can't know about homelessness in one night. I absolutely agree. You cannot know what homelessness is like in one night. You can't even know about it in 1 year if you still have an opportunity to go to a home after those 365 days are done. But what you can do is you can talk to someone who faces that loneliness and that boredom and that fear every single night. What it's like at 2 o'clock in the morning when some animal seems to be scratching at your tent, or some helicopter comes over and you don't have your house to protect you, or the train comes by and its horn is right in your ear. That's what homelessness feels like, when the world constantly is at your feet and intruding on your ability to think and to rest and to understand. That's what we're trying to do, to stimulate and educate and have everyone participate in all the things that our community can offer us. That's what I've learned by being here. What I've learned too is that we all care. We all care. It's not that we don't want these people. Nobody said, sister, we're gonna give you enough money to get them all tickets to go wherever they want in any bus you can find. What people said was help to coordinate efforts, help to bring things together. Those programs that were already doing the work for years, we didn't need to do that. We don't want to duplicate what they're doing. They're doing fine work. But what we needed to do was to recognize what the needs of the community are and to help those people move forward and to help them find the housing. Mary Alice had asked me to talk about some success stories. And I'd love to be able to say we got someone off the street and they're living in a wonderful neighborhood and they have a job and they're great. It doesn't happen that quickly for anybody's life. But I can tell you about people who have moved from abandoned buildings to connections with the VA, who have been able to go to Dublin and experience what they were having a difficult time experiencing was a connection to a place that could help them. I can tell you about people who have worked with Goodwill, have used the computers at Daybreak and the phone, who have been getting clothes at Loaves and Fishes and have been getting help in other places, lunch at Mulberry, and have been able to do those things and eventually were able to find an apartment because all of those other services supported them before they could find that housing. The St. Vincent de Paul Society was founded by a young man, a college student by the name of Frederick Ozanam. He was challenged to find the way his faith could be expressed in works. And some of the things that Frederick said, I find very profound. And this is one of the things he said. He said, the question which is agitating the world, and I would say Macon today, is a social one. It is a struggle between those who have nothing and those who have too much. It is a violent clash of opulence and poverty, which is shaking the ground under our feet. Our duty is to throw ourselves between these two camps in order to accomplish, by love, what justice alone cannot do. To me, that's a powerful thing, to throw ourselves in the way of the struggle between those who have and have earned it and have worked hard for it, and those who have so little, who don't know always how they got there, and don't know how to find their way out. To throw ourselves in the middle of that in love, because these are members of our community. To throw ourselves in the middle of that clash, and that battle, of those bootstraps, right? To throw ourselves in the middle of that and say, how can we help both sides? Because there's poverty among the richest and there's wealth among the poorest. There's poverty that we know is economic and there's poverty we know that is spiritual. Poverty exists everywhere. And it has different names and different looks, but we can all move forward. What I know about homelessness and those who live in homelessness is they need three things. They need affordable and safe housing. That's practical. Affordable and safe housing. They don't need the floors falling through or the roofs falling in. They need health care that's accessible and affordable. They need to be able to purchase it. They need to be able to get it. They might be able to get it and they can't pay their prescriptions or they can't get in, but they have a condition. They need health care that's affordable and accessible. And they need an income that is sustainable and adequate. Those are very practical things. And this is a community that can do that. One last quote from Frederick Ozanam. He says, yours must be a work of love and kindness. You must give your time, your talents, and yourselves. The person living in poverty is a unique person with an inalienable right of respect. You must not be content with tiding the poor over the poverty crisis. You must study their condition and the injustices which brought it about with the aim of a long-term improvement. Thank you very much.
I better stay behind here. When I teach, normally I walk around, so this is hard for me to stand here. But I'm going to make a turn. I think people do care. I think a lot of people have cared and have tried their best in their individual lives to combat poverty and to be compassionate. And I think a lot of those folks are really frustrated and discouraged, and would rather turn away from the problem at this point and just get on with their own lives. So the argument that I'm about to make is why those frustrated people you need to talk to and bring them back around to a different point of view and to show them why we do need to care about poverty. So, if I get out from behind, can you hear me? Is it all right if I talk really loud? You can see here, these are some local statistics. Poverty rate, we're way higher than the surrounding counties as well as the nation and the state. Graduation rate, unfortunately, way lower. Teen birth rate, way higher. Violent crime rate, way higher. Unionville Tyndall Heights is kind of a typical low-income community. Here you see a couple of pretty alarming statistics, like 48% of adults lack high school diploma, and 19% of young men ages 16 to 19 are neither in school nor employed. What are they doing? It's a question to contemplate. 71% of children do not attend a daycare, and therefore come to kindergarten already behind, already at a deficit. So here's the taxpayer burden of high school dropouts. You can see the statistic here, $596,000 in terms of lost earnings, tax revenue, increased crime costs. $90,000 is saved by the state per year for each student that's kept out of the juvenile justice system. This is an economic reason or rationale for why we need to care about poverty, because poverty is expensive. Poverty is expensive. What do these factors on this slide tell us? A student who can't read by grade 3 is 4 times less likely to graduate, and add poverty to the mix, 13 times less likely to graduate on time. 50% of the variance in inequality is determined by age 18. I could barely think straight at age 18. I made lots of bad decisions. Think about the consequences of these bad decisions if you're coming from poverty and you don't have the advantages that would help you compensate for bad decisions. 70% of inmates in prison cannot read above a fourth grade level. 90% of welfare recipients are high school dropouts. But what if 90% of students in Bibb County could earn a high school diploma? That would be an increase of about 1,200. That would be about a $15 million increase in annual earnings, $12 million in increased annual spending, consumer spending,
$25 million in increase in home sales, $1.3 million in increased auto sales, $19 million in increased annual gross regional product, and $1.3 million in increased state and local tax revenue. This is the economic argument for combating poverty. So here you see census counts. Look at the percentage of change for Georgia, Houston County, Jones, Peach, Monroe. Which county is not benefiting from the general influx of citizens into Georgia? The percent of growth being Bibb County. So wanted you to have this information so that we can have common conversation about some of the expensive consequences of poverty in Maine.
Mary Alice, thank you very much for setting the stage for me for making some comments that I'll do very quickly so that we get back on schedule, because I want you to go to these work breakout sessions and get more information. But what I would do is to change slightly the topic of my conversation. It says poverty affects us all, and I would only add to that now more than ever. Poverty affects us all. For all these reasons that you just heard, poverty is not isolated to just those who are suffering from the economic distress or from the spiritual lack, but it affects the community in so many different ways. It affects our education. Children that show up slow to learn, unable to learn, unhealthy, not able to keep up, serve as a drag on the entire class. The healthcare system cost more when people have no good health care backup. They show up at the emergency room as their primary care physician. It's the most expensive way to get care and treatment. They're not as healthy. They don't know what good eating habits are. There are all kinds of property values and blight. If you are living on $24,000 a year, the last thing you're going to worry about is painting your house. So your house begins to look shabby. That starts to pull the value down of every house around it and throughout the neighborhood. Workforce, we're being robbed daily of a qualified workforce, because if you have a graduation rate of 48% in some high schools and low 50s in the system overall, you're not going to have a qualified workforce. It leads to crime and crime statistics that affect us all. You could be directly impacted by that, or you could just pay more in taxes for more police cars and sheriff's cars to run around and try to apprehend those that are doing it. Community pride, who can be really proud of a community that's littered, that's blighted, that has high levels of poverty? Who can be proud of that? Certainly it affects all of our pride, quality of life, but more than anything else, our competitiveness. We as a community are competing with other communities across the Southeast, across the nation, and around the world for what? Jobs and people. There's a great book out now. If you haven't read it, I would urge you to get a copy of it. Jim Clifton, who is the president and CEO of the Gallup organization, wrote this book about the coming jobs war. And I will quote just one. I told President Underwood, if you're going to plagiarize, do it blatantly. So I'm reading now from page 133 of James Clifton's book. Watching current trends, 43% of black males drop out of high school, and of that percentage, more than half eventually go to prison. These statistics and subsequent formulas help local leaders know how many prisons they need to build, but they don't tell them a thing about how to turn kids into economic engines. What reverses this? Knowing what causes the dropout movement before it happens and the strategies to prevent it. This actually isn't that hard. Gallup has found that kids drop out of school when they lose hope to graduate. That's it. Not because they're lured into gangs or have to flip hamburgers to support the family. The reason they lose hope of graduating is because they don't feel excited about what's next in their lives. The moment that they feel despair about what is ahead, they start psychologically dropping out. Having no vision or excitement for the future is the cause of dropping out of school. Students need to be rescued at or before the moment they lose hope in the future. And when they aren't caught in time, they don't just drop out of school, they drop out of life. Another great book that you need to get a copy of, How the Poor Can Save Capitalism, by none other than John Hope Bryant, picks up on that same theme that I think is so profound. In the wake of Ferguson, Missouri, and other community riots where people have exerted typified the frustration with the system and the inequality of what's going on here, what's going on. John Hope Bryant writes this: "If I don't have a purpose in my life, I'm going to make yours a living hell. The poor and the underserved must be given a stake in this thing we call America, or I promise you they will tear it up right before they tear it down." This is not an alarmist statement. The most dangerous person in the world is a person who has lost hope. Why is this more important now than ever? Why did the mayor say it's more important now than ever? Because the jobs of tomorrow demand a quality education. You can't get a job in tomorrow's economy with yesterday's education. Can't do it. You've got to have that education if you're going to be competitive. Kevin Johnson, mayor of Sacramento, California, is currently serving as the president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors. And he says that we're entering the age of cities 3.0. Cities 1.0 was transportation related: rivers, stagecoach, trails, transportation, connectivity. Cities 2.0 was the Industrial Revolution, smokestacks and plants and mechanization. Cities 3.0 is information technology. It's where the world is headed. Thomas Friedman from the New York Times summed it up this way. He says the jobs of tomorrow and plants of tomorrow are going to have two employees, a man and a dog. The man's job is to feed the dog. The dog's job is to keep the man away from the machinery. The only people are going to be those with the technology and the experience and the education to go in and fix the machine, not to operate it anymore, not to feed it in or take it off. You've got to have the technology. The jobs of tomorrow demand education. The temperament that's in our community today and communities around the nation are so volatile. Violence will follow if you don't fix the problem. If you don't level the playing field and give people a chance, if you don't restore hope, they'll tear up the system right in front of you. So let's go to these breakout sessions today. Let's learn how we can intervene. Let's do something about poverty and Macon-Bibb County. My God, let's do it.